Everyone, and welcome to Geeked Week.
All week long, we've been showing you all the news from your favorite Netflix series, games, and films. And as you can tell, we're ending this week in style. It's Rebel Moon Day.
That's right. Today, we're hanging out with the man behind Rebel Moon, Zack Snyder.
Right now, we're going to show you the brand new trailer for Rebel Moon. And Zack Snyder himself is going to break it down for us.
Then, we'll be sitting with Zack for an exclusive Q&A asking him the questions you submitted to Netflix Geeked.
They were great questions.
Oh, yeah.
And it all starts now. So sit back, relax, and join us as we celebrate all things Rebel Moon.
And to start things off, here's their brand new trailer.
Roll it!
When I found you in the wreckage of that ship, I considered leaving you. I was afraid you could bring trouble to us.
What do you think they want?
Everything.
We're just farmers, we're not a threat. They won't just kill us, will they?
You're delusional. You think those soldiers will show them mercy?
Stop. We're gonna have to fight. I am a child of war. I find warriors to fight with us.
We might stand a chance.
We're searching for soldiers for a fight against the Mother World.
I could help you. For a small fee, obviously. You might want to hold on.
I'm here to make you an offer. To give you a chance at redemption.
We are beyond redemption.
What about revenge? Yeah! This isn't just pursuit of revolution.
I have found her. The most wanted fugitive in the known universe.
New age for the universe.
Hi guys, I'm Zack Snyder, and we're going to break down the trailer for my new film, Rebel Moon, Part 1, A Child of Fire.
When I found you in the wreckage of that ship, I considered leaving you. I was afraid you could bring trouble to us.
The story centers on Cora, who's living as a farmer. She's a seasoned warrior who has a sort of a mysterious past, but now she's living on Belt and sort of connecting to this to Earth and really having an experience that she hasn't had. I mean, I think the easy way to think about Rebel Moon is a sort of David and Goliath. It's a small farming community, and a warship comes to that planet seeking to take their food to feed their soldiers. From like 100 yards out into this dirt, up to the longhouse is all practical. Yeah, we built a town. I think it took about 4 months to build it. It was quite a process. And also, we had to plant wheat there, and one of the things actually that drove the schedule was where the wheat was at its correct ripeness. The guys who planted the wheat had prepared a box for me, and I brought it back to my house. So I would look out, and I had a little like measuring stick so I could see what height it was at.
What do you think they want?
So like that shot right there, that's the actual village. Where that spaceship is, we had a helicopter just kind of lowering itself, and you can see how much dust that helicopter creates.
Everything.
That foot shot is like real. That's me like, getting plastered by the helicopter trying to film the feet of the actors who are also getting blasted with the wind, by the way. They all had dirt in their ears and their noses, but they forgave me. Yeah, that's you can see him in that shot, really cowering. Admiral Noble is a brutal army leader on a mission from the Mother World to find the rebel insurgents that are in that part of the galaxy that have sort of claimed independence. And so his job is to find them and sort of snuff that out.
We're just farmers, we're not a threat.
Gunner's a farmer. He's very much connected to the land, connected to the place of Velt. His interests are really to protect the village as best he can. His dedication to his people is really unquestionable.
They won't just kill us, will they?
Of course, it's not Cora's fault that the Mother World soldiers are arriving on Velt. The only thing that she does have is this incredible perspective on what their intentions are. The villagers are like, oh, this maybe is good news. They don't understand that it's dangerous.
You're delusional. You think those soldiers will show them mercy? Stop.
So this scene, Cora has decided to leave the village, and then this young girl is being sort of dragged into this granary, and Cora realizes that she can't leave, and so she decides to intervene. The guys, of course, just think she's a farmer. Saul Sophia doing the entire scene. She learned all the fight choreography and her physical abilities are amazing. And we really tried to take full advantage of it as best we could to see like, I wonder if she can do this. And she's like, oh yeah, I can. And she, of course she did. And we couldn't think of anything she couldn't do. So that was good.
We're gonna have to fight.
And these are the villagers. They were showing up basically, you know, extending an olive branch to the soldiers. And then this is what they arrive to. All the soldiers are dead, basically.
I am a child of war.
When we did Army of the Dead, we shot that movie with gas guns. And so the big problem with using gas guns, there's no muzzle flash. And so what we did as we evolved, we basically had these LED discs plugged into the barrel. And then when you fired the gun, that flare is real. And the light on Cora is also from the gun.
I find warriors to fight with us.
We might stand a chance.
We're searching for soldiers.
You know, when you make a visual effects, a really heavy visual effects film like this, it's helpful for everyone to know what they have to build and what they don't have to build. And what's going to be in the frame. And I'm pretty clean with my storyboards as far as like, this is the frame. And so for this movie, I think I did close to 4,000 drawings for the two movies together.
For a fight against the Mother World.
I could help you. For a small fee, obviously.
Kai is a cool and great person to have on your team because he's like a Swiss Army knife. He's got all kinds of skills, including being an incredible pilot. He's also a fixer with an extensive network of things, and that's how he gets stuff done.
You might want to hold on.
Gunner kind of doesn't expect to go on the entire journey. He's not a soldier. He really doesn't know how to fight. He's absolutely us in the movie. We all watch the movie and we think, oh no, we're Cora. But really, we're Gunner. Like, let's be honest with ourselves.
I'm here to make you an offer. To give you a chance at redemption.
Tarek. Stas plays this character called Tarek, a super capable, super athletic sort of soldier. He doesn't have a shirt in the movie. His character doesn't own a shirt.
We are beyond redemption.
What about revenge?
General Titus is a fierce gladiator whose reputation as an incredible military strategist is known throughout the universe. And he ended up a wanted and sort of ousted AWOL general who now makes his living where he fights for money. It's a holiday movie, obviously. There's a lot of Christmas celebrations. One of the, they have to fight Santa. No, that's, that doesn't happen. But it is a good holiday movie, I'll tell you that.
This isn't just pursuit of revolution.
That's a little glimpse of the Blood Axes, Darian and Devra. They are a brother and sister team of revolutionaries. Devra is really the sort of leader of the revolution. Darian gets to be the more passionate. He doesn't really need to worry about the day-to-day responsibilities as Devra does. He's more of, you know, the fighting spirit of the revolution. Nemesis is a skilled swordswoman who uses this pair of special molten metal swords. She can also fight with them not on, and she does a lot of fighting before she turns them on, because once she turns them on, they're kind of deadly. When they're not on, she's probably just messing around with you.
I have found her. The most wanted fugitive in the known universe.
That creature that Tarak's riding there is called the Bennu. It was wild, and he's trying to tame it, and so he's flying around just trying to not get killed. So there's Jimmy. He's a JC class robot, of course, voiced by the incredible Anthony Hopkins, who was like a mind-blowing honor to work with and makes this creature have a soul, which was what I really wanted it to feel like. So that crane arm was real, and Ray actually had to jump super far. He's not on a wire or anything. He literally just leaped off onto this big pad. On the first one, he almost jumped off the pad and we had to move it back. And I said, Ray, don't jump quite so far. You're gonna end up on the stage floor. Yeah. This is a shot we did practically. No, I'm just kidding. This is a CG shot. But I really can't wait for audiences to strap in and get shot into this world, to have the experience and go along with these characters on the journey that they went on.
It's a new age for the universe.
I'm so excited to share Rebel Moon with you. I've been planning and working on this epic story for over 30 years. This has truly been a labor of love. So watch it on Netflix, December 22nd. My whole existence is based on getting the 3 heat weeks.
I knew it. Mm-hmm. I knew it this whole time.
You know what? Honestly, it probably is a little bit. So. Well, it's funny really and it's kind of weirdly true. So.
Joining us today is the man, the myth, the legend himself. We have got the mastermind behind Rebel Moon, Zack Snyder, in the house.
Awesome. Thank you guys for having me.
Thank you for being here.
We just saw the new trailer for Rebel Moon, and it's the most epic thing I have ever watched.
It's kind.
Truly the same. Fans are so pumped to see the trailer, and when we posted from Netflix Geeked that we were gonna be talking to you, the comments blew up, and we asked anyone if they had questions for you.
Let's go.
Get into it. I'm gonna start with Seriously Sergio, I love his name, asks, can you share a moment on set that encapsulates the overall experience of making this film?
In the making of this movie was for when the dropships are landing in Velt, which was a set that we built in the mountains. We knew the engines were strong, right, of the dropships when they were landing. We were like, okay. So we had a bunch of big giant fans and we were like, okay, we'll point them down so they blow a little bit. So we did a test and we were like, it's not enough. And so we got helicopters instead to come and descend super low right over everybody and blast them with the rotor wash from the helicopters. And so we're all there, I'm there with the camera, and the actors are like, oh, this is cool. Like, I go, it's gonna be a little bit dusty. You know, we didn't know, because we couldn't test it because we didn't want to blow the top layer of dirt away. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But sure enough, helicopter comes in, blasts just dust into the entire, every single crevice of every human and all the equipment and everything. And I was like, that was great. That was perfect. You know, that looked amazing. And all the actors were like, eyewash, you know, whatever. And they were like, okay, that was cool. We got that. And I was like, okay. So this time when the helicopter comes, it's gonna come a little lower, get a little more dirt. That was fine, but I feel like there's more to give.
But I think that once that happened, I feel like everyone kind of knew what we were going to be in for the rest of it.
We're on a journey. We're in for a journey.
You see the movie and it's serious, but you tell these stories and it's like, you know, these are made by humans and they're having fun.
It is fun making a movie. There's no two ways about it. We have a good time. And I think if you're not having a good time making a movie, then you really have to reassess just like what your idea of fun is, because it's literally pretending. We were pretending to be on another planet with space guns. If that's not fun to you, I don't know what is.
Whoa, I missed that one. Go that one again.
Listen, everyone is very happy and having a great time in this movie.
No bad guys come.
No?
They wake up and it was a dream. And yeah.
That's the ending.
They're in a snow globe or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Whatever the Twilight Zone ending is. Yeah.
The Creed is asking here, creating such massive universe seems so daunting. How long did it take to come up with the lore for the world of Rebel Moon, and what was the process like for you?
Creating the lore is really just the action of having fun with the characters in the end. You know, even just like, so Tarak, we meet Tarak, and he's, you know, in this, looks like some sort of frontier looking kind of ranchy place, and he's chained to this anvil. They've come to say like, hey, join us in this fight. And he's like, I would, but I owe this guy money and I honor my debts. And so probably could break out of this chain if I felt like it, but that's who I am. And it's just fun to say like, okay, well, who are you?
Like, it's like you're picking up 2/3 of the way through his movie when you encounter him.
Correct.
Here. Yeah.
And so we have to go do his movie. When we're writing and in the process of creating the lore and everything, we have to go like, okay, well, where did Tarak come from? Like, what is his deal? Once you start to do that work, you find yourself in a whole different universe that you have to sort of paint in the corners. And painting in the corners is always very tricky because you don't want to, you know, when you're starting to create canon, you got to be careful not to paint yourself into a corner that you that you're like, oh, geez, I wish the character could do that, but I guess I can't now because I've set them up in this way. So a lot of the work that Shay and I and Kurt have done in sort of creating the worlds is to make sure that we have our eye on the long look, you know.
Yeah, I love that. All right, our next question comes from @DangerHayden, and they sent in a video.
Zach, my question is for you, man. Your actors always tend to go through these massive, awesome physical transformations for their movie roles. And you've also spoken about how not only is it a physical transformation, but a psychological one too, and how important that is to the role. So I'm interested, for these new characters you created for Rebel Moon, how important was that physical and psychological training for people like Sophia or Charlie to get into these characters you created? Thanks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think pretty much every actor in the film was in the gym. It is important, I think. You know, their character has gone through a lot, and the gym allows this kind of chrysalis, you know, that they can get inside of, and then when they finally, like, come out, in whatever shape they're in, if it is a big transformation or a small transformation that they're going through physically, to me, that's not as important as the process of kind of going into this incubator and coming out the other side and being able to say, okay, now I'm this guy. He has a slightly different body than me as a person, you know, me walking around the world. So I think it is helpful in that way. It's more just about going into that incubator and sort of coming out, you know.
Well, I think about someone like Sophia Boutella too, right? Who is a dancer.
Incredibly
who
we fit, have anyway.
Seen. Yeah, we've seen do incredible action things like Atomic Blonde and The Mummy. But in this, I believe she did the most, if not all of her
99%
stunts.
Of the stunts is her. There's a few things every now and then we'd have to chuck her off of a, you know, scaffolding, or like she would have to get slammed like on wires into the ground. Yeah. And I'd be like, look, it's a liability. You know, like we have to shoot tomorrow. And that really was the only way I could convince her not to do it.
But she has some incredible action sequences in this
movie. Well, you know, she's incredibly physically gifted. She's super athletic. And yes, her dance background makes her a perfect stunt performer in a lot of ways. And making an action film is so much about choreography, mm-hmm. you know? And whoever you're fighting, they're gonna throw a punch at you. You have to know where it's gonna land. You have to either be able to react to it or duck it or whatever you're supposed to do. And without the ability to sort of understand the sort of repeatability of those physical actions and being able to be precise, you know, that can be slightly problematic, you can imagine. And her ability to not only do the choreography, but act the moment inside the choreography. That's the trick. You know, anyone can, not anyone, of course not anyone, but like, there's probably a lot of people that could dance the dance, but the emotional part of it, what's happening in here at the same time, that's what you get from Sophia. That's amazing.
Yeah, I love that.
Continuing here with more questions from you, the fans, we have this video.
Hi, Zach. My question is, what is it that makes the broken heroes throughout your filmography and in Rubber Moon overcome that phase in life?
Wow, broken heroes. Yeah, redemptive stories. I guess I just, you know, I find it really mythological and really kind of interesting. These characters that through the course of the movie, through the actions of the film, through the crucible that they're going through, they need to fulfill like something in themselves, whether it's simple or whether it's complex, you know, or like in Sucker Punch, whatever, just a girl, or whether it's a king, you know, that the struggle to be redeemed or to find your place is really a thing I've just always been fascinated by.
Here's the next question. Ben Parrish is asking, I want to hear more about the costumes and props that brought the world to life. Zach, what was your favorite prop or costume piece that your team got to create? Any small details to look out for?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, I mean, look, the obvious one is Noble's bone staff that he carries around.
I'm obsessed.
The idea was that it was a relic from the mother world, mythological relic that apparently there was some creature that when the first of the royal family were born hundreds of thousands of years ago, the very first king was carried across the desert by this animal. And that is the femur of that giraffe-like creature that carried him. But obviously that's not the actual one. Because if you look very closely at the staff, it's just got a little window, like a relic, and there's a little bit of bone in there. So the implication is that it's just...
It's been like worn down and they carry it on.
Maybe it's inside there, or maybe that's all they had left. So it's a very important, you know, piece of mythological history.
Oh, well, now we can't make the movie, so... Oh.
I will say, I mean, every costume, like there's so much story behind them, especially since the characters come from so many different planets. But if I had to choose, and I don't have to, but I'm going to, the Nemesis costume is like, just top to bottom.
Juno Bay, having her, you know, in the movie is unbelievable and she's amazing and I had an amazing time working with her. You know, you can see there's Korean influence, cultural influence in the costume rather than just having it be like, oh, generic swords woman. We wanted to use a little bit of her culture, so she was really excited about the hat and it was really fun.
I too am excited about the hat, for the record. This is apparently deemed the most important question of this entire Q&A, so no pressure, but buckle up. This is from at Nicholas J. Levy. They want to know, what makes a Zack Snyder sandwich? What ingredients do you like?
Oh, sandwich.
Are you a turkey guy? Ham, roast beef, talk to me, Zach.
You know, turkey for sure.
Yeah, okay.
It's lettuce, tomato, it's a lot of mayonnaise, it's a little bit of mustard probably, chopped onion, or actually raw onion, but like, you know, in its a little round. I don't know what the actual technical term.
Sliced.
Cut the sandwich in half.
Okay. Like diagonal or like
did
straight?
Did you do a diagonal?
it depends, but mostly no. Mostly straight across.
What? Why right down the middle?
I don't know.
Like, why
I just think the technical aspects of going diagonal, it's iffy, and you could end up with a disaster.
Well, now we know the official sandwich of Rebel Moon.
That's cool.
Geek Week exclusive.
You're making me hungry.
Me too.
Then it's not about sandwiches anymore. But
back to business.
Back to business. So, continuing with the fan questions, look at this handle. It's at Noble Tribe.
Maybe into some villains. We can guess.
Maybe. So he's asking, what was shooting on those costume anamorphic lenses like?
Oh, that's cool.
So those flares are fire.
He's a dork. No, that's cool. Great question. I really appreciate that. I am a bit of a dork for sort of vintage.
Geek. We're all geeks here.
I'm a bit of a geek for for vintage glass and old lenses and things like that. And it's one of those things that as a filmmaker and as a cinematographer, in some ways that's just the experience of watching the movie.
Right.
Right. And whether or not it draws attention to itself, I don't know. I feel it in every shot. Some people do and some people don't. And like for a lot of people, the movie just washes over them and that's fine. It's 100%, that's what I want. But for others, of course, it's why?
Technical.
What is that?
Yeah.
What happened? What did they do to make that? For those people, you know, the deep dive is available.
Yes, that's what we're here for.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you're director, but you're director of photography as well on this movie,
correct,
right?
On this movie, on Army and on this movie, I was the director of photography as well. And in a lot of ways, it goes back to my roots as a commercial director. I was a director cameraman in the commercial world and, you know, did that for 10 years. And then when I started making movies, they said, no, you can't do both jobs. And so I was like, okay, that's fine. And I've had, you know, amazing cinematographers I've worked with on my films and loved them and learned so much from them and had a great experience collaborating with them. And but on these last two movies, I just felt like it'd be fun to just do it myself. So, and it has.
Yeah, I love that. This next question comes from @Ijikari, and I actually love this question. Hey, Zach, I'm a big fan of your work and I love your directing style. Quick question, what is your favorite anime of all time?
Favorite anime, well.
And you could go as far back or recent as you want.
I think, look, you know, as a filmmaker, you have to say Akira. You just have to, just cause.
Tetsuo!
Yeah, it's really just like, you know, it's fundamental, it's essential. Yeah. If you don't say that, you're in the weeds, you know, which is also fine. We are doing a lot of Demon Slayer at my house right now, and so it kind of runs the gamut, you know?
Yeah, well, the fun thing about Akira, too, is it was influenced by so many different Western stories, science fiction, all that, and now we're seeing kind of the influence of anime back on this medium.
It's an incredible boomerang, and I'm a huge fan of the influence and then being influenced and then influencing back. It's a nice tennis game for everyone to be playing.
It's
also, I think, we're at the point now in culture where everything's available all the time to everyone, and so it becomes nonlinear, I think, at this point. Like, I think when I was growing up and being influenced by, like I said, movies like Akira or movies like Conan the Barbarian or Heavy Metal or whatever, it kind of happened like, you know, bricks being piled on top of each other. I think now it goes up and down and sideways, and I think that's really fun.
Yeah, I love that. Now, somehow we are already at our last question, and this has been a true delight. Thank you for indulging us and everyone at home's very, very geeky questions.
My pleasure.
This last question is from Soups Batsy, who I'm guessing is a brand new fan of yours, has never watched anything else you've worked on.
I'm gonna say Soups Batsy is a pretty...
Very into bats.
Yeah.
This is perfect last question. And it's another video.
Hi, Zach. I wanted to ask you, what's the thing you're most excited for fans to see in Rebel Moon? Can't wait for it.
There's a lot of stuff that I can't wait for people to experience and enjoy it, because we had a great time making it, as I said. But I think it's really this opportunity to sort of dig into a new mythology and like to dork out a little bit on the sort of edges of this universe, because we've done a lot of work to make them worth getting into, because there's an answer in there. It's not it's not random. It's not just cuz. I find it fun, so I hope fans do too.
Thank you, Zach, so much for taking the time with us
today.
It's my pleasure. And thank you, everyone at home, for sending us those great questions. We really appreciate it.
Yep, thank you guys so much. Can't wait for you guys to check out the movie. I hope you love it.
Rebel Moon Part 1, A Child of Fire, is coming to Netflix December 22nd.
That's our show. What a week, Lisandro.
What a week, Terry.
Thank you all at home so much for joining us for Geeked Week 2023. And what a way to close it out.
I know, Zack Snyder really gave us a treat. I cannot wait for Rebel Moon to come out.
I can't either. And fortunately, we don't have to wait long. Rebel Moon Part 1, A Child of Fire, is coming to Netflix on December 22nd.
I'm going to lose my mind. I'm so ready for this movie.
For all the latest on all things Rebel Moon, be sure to give @NetflixGeeked and @RebelMoon a follow.
Thanks for watching.